Attendees are coming in. Hello, everyone. Welcome. We're so happy that you're joining us. Get comfortable. Get yourself at home. And we're going to start in 30 seconds. Our panelists are here, and we're going to have a very fun evening all together. So, buenas noches a todos y todas. As people trickle in, we're going to say good night to all our friends. My name is Andres Jimenez, and I am Birds Canada's Urban Program Coordinator and the host for our new podcast, The Warblers. Make sure to check it out. We are so happy you can join us for another warm and fun bird night. It's been a while since we have been together behind our screens, and we are glad to bring you a new Birds Canada presentation. Thanks for the support of Firefly Books, we bring you Peter Cavanagh, author and photographer that will share with us the wonders of and challenges of bird flight. With me, Jody Allaire, my very good friend and colleague, director of community engagement, and by far the most knowledgeable and funniest of birders ever. And he will guide us through a night of exploration.
All right. Thanks for that, Andres. Peter, great to have you here tonight. There's still people trickling in. So while everyone's coming in, I'll just sort of chat a little bit about how the night's going to go. Peter's going to be giving us a presentation about his book. We'll talk about that in a second. There is a chat feature that I think many of us are used to now on these type of events. And there's also a Q&A feature. Please introduce yourselves in the chat. Let us know where you're coming in from. And we are going to have time after Peter's presentation for discussion and for questions. So please as questions come to you, put them in the Q&A, all right? And I see people are already asking questions in there. I'll take that one. The name of our Birds Canada podcast is The Warblers. So you need to please check that out. And we're gonna get started here. So I'm gonna do a quick introduction. Oh, we still have lots of people coming in here. So I'm going to do a quick introduction to our guest tonight and what it is we're going to be talking about. I'm actually really excited for this presentation. This is a real treat to talk to Peter Cavanagh. I'll just do a quick bio here. This is his book that we're going to be talking about, 100 Flying Birds, Photographing the Mechanics of Flight. I've had the pleasure of basically spending the last week diving into this book and enjoying the photos and the write-ups. And I'm really excited to learn a little bit more about this real work of art from Peter. So I'm going to introduce our guest tonight. So Peter Cavanagh is a Pacific Northwest based photographer. That's Pacific Northwest of the United States. Photographer and author who can usually be found pointing his lens skyward towards flying birds. Peter's images have been featured in the Audubon Society's Photography Awards Top 100, and he guest curated the exhibit How Birds Fly at the Seattle Museum of Flight. Peter's migration to the photography and study of bird flight evolved from his study of flight aerodynamics for aircraft pilot qualifications. His professional training in anatomy, biomechanics, and high-speed photography, and his love of nature and the outdoors. Peter is a member of the North American Nature Photographers Association, and he lives in the San Juan Islands of Washington State, USA, with his wife, artist Anne Vanderveld. Peter, so great to have you here tonight.
Jody, thanks so much. It's my pleasure to be here. And thank you so much for inviting me to launch the book. It's brand new. I just got my hands on it a couple of weeks ago. And it's an exciting moment for me. This was a pandemic project. It's something that sustained me through those dark days. And it's just really a thrill to share it with you today. So let me share my screen here and get into a brief presentation. That's the book. The bird on the front is a woodland kingfisher, very common bird in southern Africa. It doesn't actually fish. It mostly likes insects, but there you go. It's a beautiful bird. And this is a gray heron from the United Kingdom. Now, what I want to do today is tell you a little bit about me, my background, how I got to be doing what I'm doing, what my photographic journey was. tell you about the evolution of the book, how it evolved from my travels with a camera. I'll read you just one story from the book to give you the flavor of it. I'll tell you where I'm going in the future, because obviously, you know, and like Prometheus, they said, well, sure, he created fire, but what has he done since? So I'm hoping that I'm going to go on from this to develop as a photographer and a storyteller. And then, as Jody said, we'll have lots of time for your questions. So I grew up in England, and I have had a camera for as long as I remember it. I had a Brownie 127. I had a variety of Kodak box cameras. And I had a darkroom in my home, really spurred on by my mother, who had done this professionally for a while. I went to college at Loughborough. I thought I was going to be an athlete, not a scientist, professor, or a photographer. But at the time, I had a pretty fancy camera for a young guy. I had one of these Rolleiflex baby gray 4x4s, and I still own this camera. It's not a good bird camera, but it's a great piece of engineering. I went to graduate school at the Royal Free School of Medicine in London. Those are not the dates I attended, by the way. Those are the dates of the school. And I spent time during my doctoral studies studying mechanics of human locomotion using photography in different ways. My first professional job was as a professor at Penn State University, and there I also used photography to do motion capture on moving athletes. But most importantly, as Jody said in the introduction, I learned to fly there. And this was one of my first planes, a PA-28. And I became fascinated with the reasons the airplane stays in the sky. And that has proved very useful to me as I have gone on from airplanes to birds. At that time, I had my first sort of prosumer camera, which was a Canon 50D. And I then went to the University of Washington, where you see it's raining there, of course. I got my first lens, a decent lens, which was a Canon 100-400 lens. And on a day that I still remember, February the 8th, 2009, I went to a place in the Puget Sound called Fur Island with another photographer called Paul Bannock, and we photographed short-eared owls and harriers interacting with each other. Now, this is the first bird photograph that I took. It's not one I'd be proud of today, but it's a short-eared owl cruising just about a meter off the ground. I should add that the harriers and the owls were fighting at the time, and I never got a shot of that because it was just all too fast for me at the time. And I remember Paul Bannock saying to me, "Peter, don't think it's always going to be this good." And he was right, actually. It was an amazing day. But that was my beginning, and I very rapidly geared up and got myself a 500 millimeter lens and a Canon 1DX Mark I, and I thought, well, I have a camera, I'm going to travel. So I'm going to take you today on a very brief perimeter of the world trip to 8 of the places that I've been to, skipping over places that we don't have time to talk about. It's a quick trip, so we're going to spend 30 seconds, a minute in each place, and tell you a little bit about the birds that I saw and how this came together as a book. So before leaving home, I better look at the birds in my backyard. And I live on Lopez Island in the San Juans, just south of the Canadian border by the Canadian Gulf Islands. Taking a picture of a bird landing is not as simple as you might think, because you got to know where the bird's going to land. And so I had some advance scouting on this one from a friend who told me that this osprey really liked to use this branch as a perch to look for fish before it went fishing. And so I was able to get this big spread of the osprey coming into land and showing us its feet with the adaptation of roughness so that it doesn't drop the fish. I also know where this bird lives, and this movie was taken when there were two juveniles in the nest, and This bird is bored because its parents are not bringing any food. And so it decided just to pick up a dead fish tail in the nest and to hover. It's remarkable because there is no headwind. And so you notice the bird is moving its wings just horizontally because it's only gaining lift. It's not requiring any thrust whatsoever. And so it's a very interesting hover, isolated from any need for propulsion. Well, where are we going to go first? Why not Canada, somewhere where we have not been able to go for the past 18 months? Finally, we can. And some years ago, there was an eruption of snowy owls in Boundary Bay. Boundary Bay is a fantastic place for birding. It's an embankment alongside a big wide bay. And there must have been 20 or 30 of these snowy owls there for that winter. And to my knowledge, they have not been back since. Owls, of course, have remarkable specialization on the leading and trailing edges of their wings for quiet flight. They have a serrated edge on the leading edge and a ruffled edge on the trailing edge. And this has been something that flight engineers have been interested in from a biomimetic point of view, to try and copy the quiet flight of owls. Let's go up to Vancouver Airport and take a 10-hour and 30-minute flight to Tokyo. Of course, we would go west, not east, but the map shows us going there and then up to Hokkaido. And that's where I met the magnificent red-crowned Japanese cranes. These cranes are revered in Japan. They are revered for their faithfulness. They often appear on kimonos at weddings to symbolize the faithfulness to their partners. And it was a tremendously snowy day when I was there. And this is one of my favorite pictures of this bird. And it also shows how sometimes you can turn an absolutely terrible weather day into a great photographic day. There was a blinding blizzard, the airports were closed, the roads were closed, but I could walk to the place where I knew these cranes would be. And this bird was just jumping for the exuberance of it. There was no female to impress. There was no territory to guard. It just seemed to be jumping for the joy of it. Let's now move on to South Africa, Kruger National Park. And I went to South Africa and Botswana several times before I got the photograph that I wanted of this bird, which is sometimes called the German flag bird, the saddlebill stork. It's called the German flag bird because, as you see, all the colors of the German flag are in there, including the yellow on its wattle. I totally love this bird, and it was one of those moments when everything went right. I had the camera primed, I had the right settings, I had an extender on the lens, I had the tripod set, and suddenly this bird took off from the wetland where it was feeding. And I got the image that I wanted. I had previously spent a whole day staking out a nest of a saddlebill stork, and all I got was the picture on the left and of it yawning throughout a day of absolutely going nowhere. Now, also on this trip, that, by the way, is a hippo in the background, I got to see this bird, a beautiful hornbill, a trumpeter hornbill. And this bird is like a gumball machine. He has actually harvested over 30 individual fruits, bringing them back to the female who is sealed in the nest, feeding her chicks. She has done a complete molt, and she's sealed in for about 35 days while she lays eggs and raises the chicks. Once he had decided that there was enough fruit in the nest now, he does a little bit of cleaning out. You'll see that next. Here he goes. He's cleaning out some of the garbage and off he flies away. And I do have a flight shot of him still also. From South Africa, it's not too far to the Southern Ocean, and Southern Ocean is a magnificent place for a photographer to go. This is my first glimpse of the island of South Georgia. It's a birder's and a bird photographer's paradise. Of course, Many people go there for the penguin colonies. There are colonies of more than 10,000 king penguins. And this is one, and you notice how the young are stratified. And it's always remarkable to me how the penguins can go away hunting food and come back and find their own chick in the midst of this absolutely steaming mass of steaming biomass of penguins. But the birds that I was fascinated by on this trip were the albatrosses. I'm sure you're aware that humans have destroyed many, many species of albatrosses and brought them to the point where they are critically endangered, mostly from longline fishing. This particular bird is the most successful species of albatross as far as its present status. It's a black-browed albatross. And the fact that you see these birds with wings stretched is no coincidence. And this brings us, we're going to have a couple of questions along the way here to prevent you from falling asleep. And the question that I have for you here is, what percentage of their cruising flight time do black-browed albatrosses spend flapping their wings? And the choices are 4.6%, 9.1%, 26.6%, and 48.2%. So make your votes, and we're not allowed to vote because we've shared the answer in advance. So,
Peter, we've received close to 30 votes. They're coming in hot.
Okay. Do we have a leading candidate?
We're going to leave it open for 5 seconds more, okay, so we can capture more participants, and we'll show you the results now.
Wow. A very knowledgeable audience. That is the right answer that the majority of 58% of people have chosen. It's astonishing, isn't it? During a long cruising flight, and this may be hundreds of kilometers, the black-browed albatross only flies for less than 5% of its flight time. In the same paper that measured this, it was found that the heart rate, they were measuring heart rate as well as they had an accelerometer tracker on. The heart rate of the black brow is the same when it's flying as it is when it's sitting on the water. They are not statistically significantly different, which seems to be thermodynamically impossible. But of course, these albatrosses have evolved an incredibly interesting flight pattern called dynamic soaring, which enables them to exploit and harvest energy from wind shear at different levels when they fly. So amazing bird, 5% of flight, 4.6% of flight time it spends flapping. Well, let's, as most people do when they've been to Antarctica or South Georgia, go back to Chile and Patagonia. Target for me there was Andean condor. I'm sure you've all had this experience where I was told that this one place, Estancia Olga Teresa, there are always Andean condors there. Well, I waited for 3 days and a condor never showed up. And on my very last afternoon, a squadron of condors came in and I was able, at eye level, I should say, and I was able to get this picture that I had dreamed about of a condor soaring over the pampas. And this is another bird that doesn't flap, by the way, hardly ever flaps. These birds have a different mechanism. They exploit rising air masses, and they can go for hours without a wing flap. But to me, it looks like the keyboard of a cathedral organ laid out, ready for somebody to play. Just an astonishing wingspan on this bird. I should mention, by the way, that whenever you see this book icon here, that means the pictures are in the book. Well, let us head north. And one of the most famous birding roads in the world is the Mano Road, which goes from the ancient capital of Inca capital of Cusco in Peru down to Peruvian Amazonia. And I had the great pleasure of driving that road. It's scary sometimes, huge drop-offs, trucks passing, and a magnificent bird life. And one of the birds I saw along the way was this little guy, a crested, wire-crested thorntail. This is a juvenile. When you look at it, you think it's a large bee, but it's actually a bird. And this is the introduction to the hummingbird section of the book. This is a Peruvian booted racket tail. There are variations of the racket tail up and down the Pacific coast through Ecuador, Peru, and Colombia. And there's something very interesting about this photograph. And those, I'm sure most of you are aware of this, but the leading edge of the wing is usually in the front of the bird. But here we see the leading edge on the back, and the bird is on a backstroke. And that leads us to another question. And I'm pretty sure everyone's going to get the right answer to this one as well. It's about the Anna's hummingbird, the bird a little closer to home. I'm sure many of you have Anna's at your in your backyards. The question is, what percentage of their body weight during hovering do the Anna's hummingbirds support by the upstroke, that is the backstroke of their wings, rather than the down forward stroke? And we're offering you none, 5%, 28%, and 50%. So have a noodle on that one. What percentage of the body weight support is gained during the backstroke or the upstroke rather than the forward stroke?
It's been 40 seconds of the poll and people are taking more of their time to answer it. Responses are coming less hot this time, but they're coming.
Yes, this one is, there's a lot of misinformation about that. It's like also, what's the flapping frequency of hummingbirds? There's a lot of misinformation about that question too. You see numbers that are vastly too high.
That's interesting. Okay, we're gonna reveal the answer now. Boom.
Okay, I'm afraid the minority, it's in quite the minority. The answer is 28%. Yeah. Insects do a better job of that. A fruit fly, for example, does exactly 50% on the forward stroke, 50% on the backstroke. But Anna's hummingbird does 28% of its lift on the backstroke. I should add that this number was found by a very interesting experiment. In the last several years, an aerodynamic force platform has been made where the actual forces, aerodynamic forces that the bird's wing create are measured as the bird is flying. Fascinating method of study. All right, let us move on. And Andres will be delighted to know that we're now moving to the Pacific lowlands of Costa Rica.
Pura vida.
Ah, pura vida. Yes, magnificent place to bird, as I'm sure many of you who've been there know. And a bird that I fell in love there was this bird. What a crazily beautiful bird is this. This is the keel-billed toucan. It's the kind of bird that, I know I'm married to an artist, but it's the kind of bird that if you ask an artist to design a bird, it would look like this. You know, a little dab of orange, a little blue, a little maroon, some black, some yellow. Catching this bird flying is not easy. These birds move with the speed of light. They're very jumpy. They hop about. I was very pleased to get this picture of a keel-billed toucan leaving a feeder with a piece of banana at the lodge in Boca Tapada. Well, reluctantly, we will leave Costa Rica and we're almost home. And I actually passed this place this morning as I was leaving the island to come down for Thanksgiving, American Thanksgiving, with my children. I passed this field and there was not a bird in the field this morning, but this is the time of year when we get a migration of snow geese. And this field on this day had thousands of snow geese. And I love the way the flight departure propagates through this flock. It goes from left to right, from back to front, until after, about a minute, even the stragglers, and I stop it before that, but even the stragglers had left. Sometimes the birds come right at you and the sky darkens as this flock leaves. It's an astonishing experience. Well, I suppose I should, before moving towards a conclusion, say that why do I choose flight to photograph? And I want to give you two examples. Here's a tawny eagle that I photographed on a recent trip to Namibia. Nice bird, you know, decent picture. But by waiting until the bird had flown, I ended up with this picture. And I think there is no contest between picture of a perching bird and a flying bird. What I say in the book is that flight is the essence of birdness. It's why birds have been so successful. It's why we have more than almost 10,000 species of birds. Flight has allowed birds to migrate, to escape predators, to move to different food sources. And so that is why I am fascinated with flight. Another example, this is an endangered lappet-faced vulture, again from Namibia. Good bird, nice bird to photograph perching, but look at the difference in this flying photograph. Here, the primaries, these huge primaries of this bird that has almost a 3-meter wingspan. They're hanging like scimitars as it's flying. And so for me, there is no contest between the portrait shot and the flight shot. So let me just now tell you a little about the evolution of the book. In my travels, the places I've shown you and the other places I haven't, I have shot more than 500,000 images. Every image has a story, and every bird competes daily for survival, and every image has unique camera settings. And what I wanted to do was showcase the images, tell the stories, inform my readers about flight mechanics, photographic techniques, and the conservation status of the birds. And the way the book is laid out is shown here. This is one story. It's a yellow-legged gull that I took on Texel Island in the Netherlands. I show the species name, some physical data, the conservation status, the population estimate and trend, where it was taken, the time it was taken, what the camera settings were, and then the story and the image. So in one chapter, there are 9 stories. Here you see all of the stories and the photographs in the Gulls and Terns chapter. There are a total of 11 chapters, and together with an epilogue, footnotes, further reading, and an index that make up the full 320 pages. I want to read you just one story, an example here from page 98 of the book about a black skimmer. This was taken on the Cuiaba River in the Pantanal in Brazil. It was taken in July. So arriving in a new part of the world and encountering a familiar bird is like an unexpected meeting with an old friend. Granted, this subspecies is different from the birds I've seen in Texas, and there are minor, almost indistinguishable color differences. However, the unmistakable bill and feeding behavior of this black skimmer welcomed me back to common ground. The image was taken at the end of a particularly rich and exciting day, starting at Porto Jofre, a small community at the southern end of the Transpantaneira Highway in Brazil's Pantanal. After photographing the iconic Toco Tucans in the early morning, our day had included close-range sightings of jaguars, giant otters, and the world's largest living rodents, capybaras. As the late afternoon sun turned the Cuiaba River into a strand of liquid gold, we guided our small boat into the calm eddy to end the day photographing skimmers feeding. The magical light seemed at first to be its own reward. But as I continued to shoot, adjusting my settings for the decreasing light, it soon became obvious that several birds were wiping out, cartwheeling, bill over tail, and crashing into the water. I do not know if these were young birds just learning the trade or experienced adults who felt that the benefits of deep exploration with their bills outweighed the risks. This encounter reminded me that we observe so much flawless flight behavior in birds that it comes as a real shock when they make a mistake and something goes radically wrong. Well, I want to now begin to wrap up by talking a little bit about the state of birds. You're all well aware that the ICUN rates every living thing in the world, plant, animal, according to these categories, from least concern to extinct. The birds that I have shown in the book are on the whole spectrum of these, but there is a story that is a through story about loss that I want to tell you about. This, for example, is the striated caracara on the Falkland Islands. It's near threatened. There are a maximum of 2,500 of these birds, although their population is stable. This magnificent, largest of all eagles I saw in the Nemuro Peninsula in Japan, there are a maximum of 3,800 adults, and they are decreasing. This incredible bird is a marvelous spatial tail, a hummingbird found in only one valley, the Huembo Valley in northern Peru. There are between 250 and 999 of these birds, and their numbers are decreasing. The bird is endangered. The Japanese red-crowned cranes, so revered in Japan, are endangered. There are approximately 1,830 adults, and they are decreasing. The wandering albatross is vulnerable, 20,800 birds and decreasing. I say in the epilogue, and I'm sure many of you know this, that in 2019, a coalition of biologists from the United States and Canada reported that there are 3 billion, with a B, 3 billion fewer birds in North America than there were only 50 years ago. That is a staggering loss of biomass and a staggering loss of species. And what has been pointed out by Paul Ehrlich and others, that it's not, you miss the point if you only talk about extinctions. There is massive decline in population of birds that were never thought to be even close to extinction. And so at the end of the epilogue, I sort of ponder, what can photographers do to help this situation? I mean, and I'll read you just a brief part from the epilogue. We travel to places that most people only know from magazines and nature documentaries, and we bring back images that can awaken consciousness. We visit the great reservoirs of avian biomass, such as the Pantanal in Brazil or the Amazonian regions of Peru, that are most threatened by deforestation and climate-induced wildfires. It's my hope that by capturing and sharing the ethereal beauty of bird flight, I might nudge some readers to take a more combative and evangelical stance on turning back the tide of the sixth extinction. So what does the future hold for me as a photographer? Well, there are always new cameras. And I have a camera now, which I sometimes just shake my head at this camera as to how it's able to perform. I have a Sony A1, and this picture, which was taken in Costa Rica of a king vulture, you notice that the eye is very sharp. Well, this camera has artificial intelligence to detect the eye of a bird and to follow it as it moves throughout the field. And so sometimes I think it's cheating. You know, I look in the viewfinder and I think, how did it do that? That's really incredible. It allowed me to get this shot, also taken in Costa Rica, of a male resplendent quetzal coming in with a small avocado to feed to its two chicks in the nest. This is 8 separate exposures that I have composited together, and every one of them was in sharp focus. Last week, I came back from Haines, Alaska, where I've been shooting bald eagles, and what an aggressive a group of birds these were. And here you see an adult just wanting to teach a young bird a lesson. So I'm looking to develop my photography. I'm looking to my quest is for the perfect shot. I know I'll never get it, but I shall never stop trying. Thank you very much indeed for listening. You can find me on Instagram at Peter Cavanagh Birds, Facebook at Peter Cavanagh Birds. You can find my website at petercavanagh.us, and I'd be happy to answer your questions.
All right. Wow, Peter, thank you so much for that really just wonderful tour of these amazing birds and this wonderful presentation about all the different things that you are trying to combine with your work. And so I do have a couple questions I want to hit you with, but I want to remind everyone right now that if you have any questions for Peter, we have time. Please put your questions in the Q&A and we will get those to Peter for you. But in the meantime, while people are thinking about some questions to ask, I've got a few. And I think, you know, for me, as a conservationist and as someone who's been in the bird conservation realm for, you know, most of my adult life, the points you were making about the power of photography to inspire conservation action, to get people involved. And I know this is something that Andres has done and continues to do. And I know is in a lot, really feels the same about this type of thing and the importance of it. I know he's done a lot in Costa Rica of this. It really resonates with me too, because I think, you know, there are a lot of birds, and I think some birds that people maybe would never have heard of before that are absolutely wonderful that need more attention. And I think that the marvelous spatula tail is a perfect example, which I think is just one of the most beautiful photos of the book. And it's all its kind of rawness. And so I wanted to ask a little bit more about that and whether you think this is something you're seeing more bird photographers are trying to make a difference. Is this a trend that's happening, or is there more that needs to be done in your opinion?
Well, there's one very well-known photographer who's done a great job of this, and that's Joel Sartori. There is a book that Joel Sartori has written called Birds of the Ark. And he's got, you know, other animals of the ark. And I think that one book has done a great deal to bring to people's attention. I have not met this bird, but I want this bird to continue to exist in the world. And that's what I hope to do too. And the marvelous spatula tail, it's a great example of that. You know, I had the privilege of photographing a maximum of 1,000 of this organism that exists in the world. Unfortunately, those numbers are decreasing. There have been great efforts and they may be successful. I mean, there have been some heroic efforts, as you well know. Think about the California condor that was down to something like 24 birds. But even then, it's still not stable. It's still not guaranteed that we're going to be able to have that bird in 50 years' time. So I think there's much more to be done. And I must say that my own direction is, as I chart what my next book will be, which way I will go, the fate of some of these declining birds weighs heavily on my mind. And quite what the best way to do it, I don't know. You know, I wonder if every photograph that you print, you put the number of birds that still exist right on the photograph to sort of grab somebody's attention. I would be very interested in the audience's view on how the impact could best be made, because it has to be made. We are destroying, as you know, we're destroying habitats, we're losing birds, and photography is certainly a way to raise the flag, to raise the red flag.
Yeah, no, that's an excellent point. I think many of us, you know, are trying to find our niche and trying to find our way to try to do what we can for birds and for conservation. So I love that, you know, you're taking your talents and trying to do good with it. I think that's, you know, that's very, very commendable. Your book is different in a way from many other, you know, bird photography books I've seen because of this emphasis on flight mechanics, which I really enjoy because I quite like flight mechanics and I think it's just fascinating, the different wing shapes and designs and designs for different habitats and different types of air circulation. It's fantastically, if birds aren't fascinating enough, right? Their ability to adapt to their climates. And it's not just their plumage or their behaviors. It's also like their wings and how they fly, right? It's really incredible. I loved learning all the tidbits of flight mechanics throughout the book. And I think it's one of the, you know, that's one of the real key values. I also loved your extra reading and the epilogue. I actually thought the end of the book has some really solid value in there. So, you know, anyway, so well done on making something I think sort of stands out as different from many of these books that we do see. But it does bring up one question. And I think I want to ask about, you've been doing this for quite a long time. I know there's quite a few people here that are probably really interested in bird photography. Do you have any advice for people that are maybe just starting on their bird photography journey? And I will put myself in that camp. Andres, I don't believe you at all. No way. You're so much more an advanced photographer.
I wander around with a camera and I take it out for 2 minutes after I walked it for 8 kilometers. So, you know, I'll put myself in that camp.
Yeah, well, I do. First of all, don't wander around with a camera. You've got to be more intentional about it. I would say this, start with a large bird. And now this sounds kind of crass, but it's really important. If you're thinking of photographing songbirds in flight, forget it. Because what you'll get is 100 pictures of a branch where the bird was perching just like 500 milliseconds ago. Now, there are technical ways now with circular buffers that help you, and I talk about those in the book, but do not start with songbirds. Find yourself a great blue heron, a great lumbering bird who flies slowly, big wing flaps, give you plenty of time to get the bird in your viewfinder. Have your focus set on multiple focus points rather than just a single focus point that you have to keep on the bird. Now, sometimes you'll get a picture of the background and the camera will go to the background, but mostly it will go to the bird. So start with a monster bird like a great blue heron and gradually refine your goals until you get smaller birds. Use your birding knowledge of where the bird likes to perch, because I have spent many, many hours waiting for birds to take off. And I always have the camera on a tripod. I have ruined several tissues in my shoulder joints from holding a big rig out for 10 years. And I definitely do not advise people to do that. Cameras have got much lighter. And so you can find now a light camera and say a 1-400mm lens. But find out where the birds like to roost and stick with them. You know, birders and photographers are generally like oil and water. They're totally incompatible. When a birder sees a bird, they want to identify it and move on to the next bird. When I see a bird, I want to stop and say, okay, what can I learn about the behavior of this bird? When's it going to fly? Is it going to fly? I'll wait here for 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours if I have to. And of course, that makes birders very angry. And I understand why, because they want to get on and see more birds. But I want the flight shot. So have patience and put your birding instincts aside. Don't worry about whether you're going to see 32 species this morning. If I get one good flight shot in a day, I'm very happy. And so it requires a change of mindset. Set up, get a tripod, and be happy with a couple of really good shots.
Jody, I think this is why you and I are wanderers with a camera. And before you continue with your questions, I'm going to be the audience champion here. We have some questions coming in. The first one is for you, Peter. What would be the best way to purchase the book in a way that you receive the most from the purchase?
Oh, well, that's a very kind question. I don't know the answer to that. You know, quite honestly, I've not done this as a commercial money-making venture. It's obviously nice to get book royalties, but I think you buy it from a store. I personally like to go in independent bookstores. Mm-hmm. So I would say go to your local independent bookstores, enjoy chatting with the owner, browsing all the other bird books. And if you buy the book, I shall be very happy.
And our very good friend, Melissa Silberberg from Firefire Books is here. So Melissa, if you can use the chat to drop us a note on where to buy the book, that will be awesome. I have one more question for you. Joanne McLeod says that she's so inspired, as many other people, about your book and that she can help with photography to birds. And she asks, I want to go to Peru. Yep. Where should I start as a woman traveling? I want a safe guide or group.
Yes, that's a really important question. And I have to say that I rarely, even as a man, ever go in these remote places without a local guide myself. And there are many good places, reputable, environmental travelers who companies that can help travelers. I do know such a group in Peru, and I'd be happy if you can make the connection through Andres. I'd be happy to let you know of who that group is. I can tell you actually, it's called Ecologistica Peru. And I'm sure that you can find their website, Ecologistica Peru.
I've written it in the chat in Spanish, so you can Google it. And I'm also going to leave my email there.
Great. They're great people. And I've traveled twice with them.
All right. Awesome. And yeah, and I'll just say to Joan, as someone who leads birding tours with Eagle Eye Tours to all parts of the globe, my advice is, find a reputable birding tour company that goes to these places, right? And there's a couple great companies in Canada, Eagle Eye Tours, Quest Nature Tours. There's lots of, and being part of an organized tour is a good way to do that. But as Peter mentioned, a lot of these destinations have fantastic companies and setups for group tours as well. And it's a great option. So
I should mention to answer the question too, sort of leading off from the difference between birders and photographers, that you really got to make sure that the composition and the goals of the trip meet what your goals mm-hmm. are. If you want to see a lot of birds, then you should go with a birding group. But as a photographer, if you want to get good bird photographs, you should not go with the birding group, because you will be slowing the birders down. Yeah. And you'll find that it won't be a good chemistry, because you want to get the light right. You want to get the posture right. You want to move around. You want to stay. You want to dwell. So it's really important that you find a group that shares the goals that you have for the trip. Otherwise, it could be very frustrating for you and for your fellow travelers.
Yeah, and it's actually a trend now that birding tour companies are offering bird photography tours. And I know one of my friends, Steve Ogle in British Columbia, who's a birding tour leader and an incredible photographer, leads bird photography tours. And I think a lot of the birding tour companies now are offering that exact thing what Peter's saying, so that you could take the time. And the emphasis is photography, not so much a list. And I do want to insert, Peter, like, I think I have a different interpretation with birders and photographers. I see us as under one big umbrella of birding and birders, enjoying birds in different ways. And I think, you know, not all birders are running off to get their list really high, and not all photographers want to linger all day too, right? So it's, yeah. I think it's all sorts of variation, because I, without a camera, have spent hours just watching bird behaviors, you know, without a photograph, which I'm sure you'd respond, I probably should have had a camera for that.
Yeah, I should apologize for being stereotypical, but I was trying to make the difference. Yeah. You know, that at the extremes, they don't mix. Somewhere in the middle, I think they can mix, as you rightly said.
Can you tell us, and I do want to send a reminder to people, please, if you have any, we still have a few minutes here. If you have any questions about Peter and the places he's been, questions about
the more questions from the chat.
Perfect. Please okay. put it in here. And Andres, I'll let you jump in with a few questions, and then I want to end off with a question or two.
So Michael Webster asked, and I'm going to leave the really tough questions for last, because I think Jody and you can take on the really tough one. Michael Webster asks, if you have read a book from Jonathan Livingstone called Seagull, because that's where he learned everything he knows about flight mechanics.
Yeah, I saw that question, actually. I actually mentioned this book in the chat, and it's kind of interesting because, as you know, as birders, there is no bird that has seagull in its name. There's gull, there's sea, but there's no seagull, even though we all call them seagulls. Yes, I read it a long time ago, but I have to say that the memories of flight mechanics did not stay with me in that book, but I will look at it again. And now you raise it. Thank you for bringing it up. I will look at it.
And now Melissa also sent us information on the chat of where to find the book. And she says that you can find it across North America and in the UK at independent book retailers, bookstore chains like Indigo and BNN and Amazon and some museum shops as well. And now Ken Meyer, I hope I pronounce your last name right, Ken. Are we at risk of threatening all species as we work to protect narrowly speciated birds as humans approach 9 to 10 billion?
Okay, I think if I understand the question right, it's by concentrating on a few critically endangered species, are we missing the point to care for the thousands of species that are also declining? Is that the nature of the question?
I think it is.
Yes, and I think that's absolutely right. You know, I mentioned in the book a group who says that it is very commendable and wonderful that so much effort has been put into whooping cranes, California condors, and other birds that are critically endangered. But it is missing the point. The point is that birds are in almost every case declining. There are a few species that are doing well, but many birds are declining, and that is the red flag we should be seeing. We should be looking at the broader picture of all birds instead of these few iconic critically endangered birds. We should obviously do the best for them that we can, but it needs to be a broader net.
Thank you, Peter. I want to hear from Jody. For those that do not know Jody as well as I do, he has been working in bird conservation since he was pretty much 12, and he has given his life, and his life's work is towards the conservation of wild birds in Canada and many other locations. So I want to understand how Jody sees this issue.
Yeah, no, it's a great question. I think for me, it's we have to do both, right? I think we need to work to keep, we have to understand that birds are facing increasing pressures, whether it's through habitat loss, climate change, pesticide use, urban expansion, you name it. They're getting pressures on all sides around the world. And we need to work to try to keep common birds common. But we also have to do, in my opinion, everything we can for the most fragile species that are on the precipice of not being around anymore. I think losing just one of those species is a failure as humans, you know, is our failure if that ever happens. So I think we need to do both. And I think Peter's right? Like we do have to understand it is for sure a broad issue, but we can't forget the species that are most fragile, like Akikiki on Kauai, which there's only a few dozen, and marvelous spatula tail that's confined to this one area of Peru. And shout out to American Bird Conservancy for working to try to protect that area. We have to do both of these things through many of our actions. And sometimes they're very specific to target things like whooping cranes, but other things, they could be broader things that we can be doing. And there's actually, you know, shout out to our own website, birdscanada.org. There's some great tips there for people to help make some of those decisions to try to save birds. And I would say that Peter is helping that cause with this particular book, because I think he's not only showing the beauty of birds, but also sharing some of the stories of some of those really fragile species, like those amazing cranes in Japan, right? Like, I have to go see those at some point. I'm very jealous of you going to Hokkaido to see those. And I think one of the first steps is inspiration, right? You know, it's obviously hard to conserve something unless you care about it. And I feel like books and some of the words that Peter has provided in this book is one step towards inspiring people to hopefully make positive change for birds.
Thank you, Jody. Jody, can I put one more question in for Peter from the audience so you can...
Let's do it.
All right. So Amanda McGuire asks, I am a beginner birder, and I'm wondering what kind of zoom lens would be good for photographing birds and birds in flight?
Yeah. Amanda, there are a lot of lenses that are in the range of 100 millimeters to 400 millimeters. They zoom over that whole range, and they really have got to be quite light. And so you can handhold those without worry about, overusing certain joints. So I would suggest 100 to 400 zoom lens is a great starting point. You'll probably find that most of the time you've got it at 400, but it's also easy to dial it back so that you can get the larger birds when you're close to them and some of the smaller birds.
Awesome.
Now, of course, mirrorless cameras are really coming on hot and fast. And the difference, just to briefly mention it, the old single lens reflex, the picture's recorded on your card, but you really have no idea whether that picture was underexposed or overexposed. With a mirrorless camera, you actually see a copy of what is being recorded on your memory device. And so it's kind of transformed the whole issue of getting a good picture. So I would encourage somebody who hasn't yet got a camera to make a start with a mirrorless camera rather than to go back to the old single lens reflex cameras. Mirrorless cameras are incredible. And for flight photography, what's changed the game for me is focus tracking. Focus tracking means once the camera grabs onto the object, wherever the object goes, the focus tracking goes. It's cheating.
No, that's awesome. That's great advice, Peter. I'm not sure that's cheating at all, but I think that's...
I kind of feel it's cheating. As someone that cannot do that, it's definitely cheating.
It's cheating given the 10 years that I've spent trying to keep my focus spot on the bird. Now the camera just does it.
I think we probably need to wrap this up, Peter. You know, it's been really great getting to know you the past week, and I hope we're at a point now where I can start sharing some of my photos, and you can tell me all the things I've done wrong with them, so I can learn a little bit more.
And you can tell me which birds I should go and photograph next. That would be great.
Yeah. Well, you know, hey, come on up to Alberta
or Toronto.
Get some of these amazing prairie birds out here. Andre, are there any last questions? And if there's not, maybe you could tell people about how people could maybe win a copy of this amazing book.
So be sure to fill in the exit survey after I close the Zoom webinar, or to fill in the survey from the follow-up email you will get tomorrow. And we will draw one lucky winner to get this amazing book.
Awesome. Peter, thank you so much for joining us. It's been a real pleasure. Thank you for sharing all this fantastic knowledge.
Thank you so much. It's been my pleasure to be here. Bye, everybody.
Okay. Have a good night, everyone. Good birding.